Good morning. What a beautiful morning it is on this campus with all the flowers and all the plants in bloom and all the promise of the future. We gather for a day and a worship time of great celebration. There is sadness as we say goodbye to the full-time work of Dr. Dombkowski Hopkins on this campus. But I think the overall experience is one of joy and celebration and thanksgiving. I look out at the people seated here, and there are so many old friends, so many people whose lives have been touched by Denise and whose ministry has been shaped by Denise. Let me say, I think this is an experience to remember what is most important about a seminary. This is a time in the history of theological education that when that question is being asked everywhere. For instance, is a campus most important? What classes do we need to teach? There's lots that's important about a seminary, but as enduring as these walls are, is the importance of faculty. A faculty who will be here for a long time and who will in the process create the character of a school to make it a school of thought. And I can't think of anyone who's had that kind of impact as much as Denise. And so we gather to thank her and to celebrate her ministry among us and the way in which she has shaped this institution and the thousands of students who have benefited from her teaching. Let us worship together.
We invite you to remain seated. Sing together, Morning Has Broken.
Good morning. I would ask that as you can and are able, if you would stand for the call to worship. I will read the one and you will read that which is in bold. As we come together, let us settle into stillness. Let your cares and weariness fall away.
We are one with the one who is mystery, who created the heavens and the earth. Oh, marvelous mystery, amen.
Please remain standing as you're able for the prayer and litany.
Let us pray.
Sing praise to God.
Lord, our Lord,
how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Your glory is chanted above the heavens by the mouth of babes and infants.
You have set up a defense against your foes, still the enemy and the avenger.
Sing praise to
when I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, what are human beings that you are mindful of them? Yet you have made them little less than God. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands. All sheep and oxen,
and also the beasts of the field,
the birds of the air and the fish of the sea,
whatever passes along the coasts of the seas.
O Lord, our Lord,
how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Sing praise to God.
Please be seated.
Wind chimes are a decorative arrangement of pieces of metal, glass, bamboo, or other materials that, when influenced by a breeze, are struck together to make a chime or tink or ring sound. In some wind chime societies, there are 5 tubes hanging in the arrangement to represent the balancing of feng shui's 5 natural elements: earth, fire, metal, wood, and water. In others, there are connected pipe-sized tubes, a single bell, or a bubble-shaped glass piece with a hanging clapper. Wind chimes have been found to be a derivative of bells found in prehistoric times by Southeastern Asian cultures near about 3000 BC. Archaeological research has shown that the Mediterranean and Egyptian societies also created bells and wind chime forms about the same time period. It was the Asian ancient civilizations that innovatively refined wind chimes. The Chinese created the feng ling, wind bells, hung from shrines and pagodas to ward off evil spirits and to attract benevolent ones. Modern scientific music therapy even suggests and supports that particular tones and resonance of the chimes can improve physical and emotional health and well-being by bringing peace while de-emphasizing unpleasant sounds. The Japanese wind chimes were called the furin, or wind bells, and many times taken into the forest to be hung from bamboo trees and determine good or bad fortune. Today, Japanese wind chimes may be found on porches as a reminder of the cool breeze on a summer day, as well as to protect from evil spirits. The Korean wind chime, Pyongyang, is traditionally hung from the corner of a Buddhist temple, and the bell's clapper is in the shape of a fish, which is a favorable sign in Buddhism. While wind chimes are considered religious objects hung from temples, shrines, and pagodas, Western culture adopted the wind chimes in or about the 19th century and became quite popular, such that they may be found in gardens and decks and patios for decor. I've created a wind chime here to share with you using instruments of praise and worship to my God. God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, the Holy Spirit. You'll see that the commonly used metal tubes that are hanging from twine are there. Then there's a symbol here. I kind of took it from Psalm 150 that talks about the praise with the cymbals and tamarines and instruments. So then you'll also see the tamarines. There's one here and one in the middle. And then a drum-like cover on the one in the middle, so you kind of get that drum sound. And small bags of frankincense and myrrh pieces are right at the top in these little burlap bags, 3 bags to represent the Trinity. This Bible, the Bible has referenced these items in various verses of praise and worship on different accounts. Then I've painted the top here, which you may not be able to see, but there are hues of blue, and that gives me a sense of peace. And then there's a red bottom on the bottom there, and that one reminds me that I'm covered by the blood of Jesus, and it reminds me of Jesus's blood sacrifice for my sins and redemption. So this is one that I kind of cut out and made myself. Then I came up with a wind chime haiku. I love poetry, so I'd love to share that with you.
Thank you.
And it's entitled The Comforter's Psalm. Souls sense surroundings. Perceive air's natural move. Swish, tink, rustling wind. Thank you.
Some words about and from wisdom from the book of Proverbs. Doesn't wisdom call, and doesn't understanding raise her voice? On the heights, beside the way, at the crossroads, she takes her stand. Beside the gates in front of the town, at the entrance to the portals, she cries out, "To you, O people, I call, and my words are to all who live." O simple ones, learn prudence. Acquire intelligence, those who lack it. For I will speak noble things, and from my lips will come what is right. For my mouth will utter truth. Wickedness is an abomination to my lips. All the words of my mouth are righteous. There is nothing crooked or twisted in them. They are all straight to one who understands, and right to those who find knowledge. Take my instruction instead of silver, and knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is better than jewels, and all that you may desire cannot compare with her. This is the word of the Lord.
Today, we give thanks to God for Dr. Dombkowski Hopkins, who has faithfully and with integrity served Wesley Theological Seminary, the church, and the world in her role as the Woodrow and Mildred Miller Professor of Biblical Theology and Hebrew Bible.
Professor Dombkowski Hopkins, you have done all in your power to give sound instruction, counsel, and inspiration to those who study the Hebrew scriptures. We, all of us, your community, give witness before God to the ways you have contributed to scholarship, cultivated responsible interpreters of our sacred texts, and helped us discern mercy and justice in narratives ancient yet resonant.
I thank God for the grace and love that abided with me in the work of the Academy, Church, and service to the world. I thank God for the communities, families, friends, students, colleagues, guilds, and congregations that celebrated my talents and embraced my calling.
Professor Dombkowski Hopkins, your employment ends. But your calling and identity as a child of God will never change. Beloved, Will you remain steadfast to your baptismal vows, to do justice, to love kindness, and walk humbly with your God all the days of your life?
With the help of God and community, I will.
We honor all that you have done, and we build on the good works you have started.
We thank you, we bless you as you go forth in this new season.
My tissue. I am overwhelmed, absolutely overwhelmed to see so many of you who have come from so far to be here, former students, former colleagues. I'm very grateful. And I really do want to lift up, well, Andrew's back there. He's my son-in-law with my grandson, Andrew Douglas Warner Jr. Who is a little over 4 months old. My daughter Ariel is in the front row. Ariel, would you stand up? My son Brian is next to them. Brian. And I want to acknowledge David Hopkins, my former partner in life. And Andrew, hello back there. My granddaughter, Eliza Rose, is in daycare because she's three, and if she were here, she would be right up here with me. So, yeah, you all know that. Good morning. Many of you do not know that I came to Wesley in 1986 after 6 years teaching at Lancaster Theological Seminary in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. I came as a shared appointment with my ex-husband, David Hopkins, two for the price of one plus a dollar, is what he used to say. There are not many who share appointments in academia these days who can afford it, but we wanted to raise our children with shared and equal responsibility and to model that for others. We also modeled divorce. We arrived 8 years after the drowning death of my 23-year-old brother, who died on my mother's birthday in 1978. In good Jewish fashion, our son Brian is named after my brother. I thought I was going to be a Qumran and early Judaism scholar, but my research interests careened toward the Psalms, and particularly the angry laments, because of my brother's death. Those laments enabled me to remain in the church despite my anger, my despair, my questions. I have spent a lifetime honing those questions and encouraging others to ask their own. It is no surprise then that I have repeatedly begun my introduction to Hebrew Bible class with a quote from Rainer Maria Rilke, a poet and novelist born in Prague who died in 1926. In his series of letters to a young poet, as they are called, he wrote to a young man, Franz Kapos, who was 19 and about to enter the German military in 1903. Kapos wanted guidance and a critique of some of his poems. In the fourth letter, Rilke wrote, "Have patience with everything that remains unsolved in your heart, try to love the questions themselves. At present, you need to live the question. You need to live with it. Perhaps you will gradually, without even noticing it, find yourself experiencing the answer some distant day." Unquote. As my career winds down, I find myself no closer than Job to answers, and answers in the plural, there is not one answer to anything. I find myself no closer than Job to answers to my questions about innocent suffering. But in my collaborative work over the years with colleague Michael Koppel, our associate dean, on the intersections between the Bible and pastoral care, I have been able to articulate more clearly the questions and share how vital these questions are for a healthy life. My introduction to Hebrew Bible course has centered on the questions and the tensions that arise from those questions in those biblical texts that we wrestled with together. As I've told students year after year, tension is my favorite word. Oh, but it is so easy, too easy, to avoid the questions, suppress the questions, sidestep the tensions. Unfortunately, we all too often come to the Bible as what Eric Seibert calls compliant readers, who read the Bible trustingly, embracing its assumptions without question. It's the Bible, after all. Seibert argues that, quote, compliance is typically the default mode of readers who grow up in the church, unquote. You listen up, future pastors. If that happens in your church, I will haunt you. These readers take the text as is, which is, as I suggest, like buying an as-is house on the market whose price you can't negotiate because of bad plumbing or a leaking roof. Laity and pastors who read scripture in Sunday services as if they were reading a phone book, remember those phone books, remember? They are guilty of taking scripture as is. Thank God for biblical storytellers like Gene Dudek, yes, and Tracy Radosevich, who teaches a course on biblical storytelling at Wesley. The Bible does not come with stage directions. You've heard me say that many times, which means when you read the text aloud and don't read it like a phone book, but pause, whisper, shout, speed up, you are already interpreting it. Reading the white fire, as the rabbis call it, between the lines of the black fire. Reading the Bible like a phone book relieves us of our responsibility to interpret, to engage with the text. Seibert calls readers who enter into a conversation with the biblical texts, who actively engage with it, who ask questions of it, conversant readers, who are, quote, prepared to resist what they read when it is offensive, dehumanizing, or morally deficient, unquote. This is what Dana Fuel talks about in her book, The Children of Israel. Reading with interruption, stopping the text when sensing something is wrong, reading on behalf of the voiceless and marginalized in the text, reading to question rather than to simply accept, imagining a different ending. Reading in this way becomes an ethical encounter. It is the only way to read a biblical text. Now, as much as I appreciate the boldness of woman wisdom that Jean portrayed for us, because she dares to penetrate the public domain of men in ancient Israel by standing at a busy intersection, as much as I applaud woman wisdom's claim at the end of Proverbs 8 that she was with God at the beginning of creation and that this is the source of her authority, Given all that, I must exercise my responsibility as a conversant reader. I must stop and read with interruption on two fronts. Number one, theologically. Number two, pedagogically. Number one, theologically. What's at stake in Woman Wisdom's claims? On the surface, she seems to be dispensing really good advice. My two grown children keep reminding me that they are grown and I can dial back on the advice, right? Okay, you two. All right. She claims her teaching leads to life. But let's look below the surface. Who is the audience being addressed by the Book of Proverbs? Now, my students who have a paper due this Wednesday, an exegetical paper, this is step four of the roadmap for biblical interpretation, okay? Proverbs, of course, is one of the biblical wisdom writings that include Job, Ecclesiastes, or Kohelet, wisdom psalms like Psalms 137, 119, and the Wisdom of Solomon in the Apocrypha from the first century BCE. There are many parallels to biblical wisdom literature in ancient Egypt, Mesopotamia, and Babylonia. It was an international movement. Now, here's the audience. The purpose of Proverbs is to educate young men from the upper classes. Wisdom was, after all, as my teacher Jim Crenshaw at Vanderbilt has argued, very conservative, very traditional, pragmatic, and oh so optimistic. Successful living was within everyone's grasp, or at least within the grasp of the upper class, which was about 5% of the ancient Israelite population. Wisdom comes from God. It is anchored in creation. It's woven through the world. One has to search for that God-given order to live successfully. Only a fool would abandon that search. Okay, I can agree with that. However, teaching these young men to find wisdom was meant to form their character, help them make sense of adversity, and enable the passing of knowledge to the next generation. Crenshaw insists rightly that... Oh dear. Okay, this happens in the classroom all the time. I remember once I showed up without any of my notes and I thought I would just fall apart and everything went fine. So now I have to reprise in my mind's eye an entire page of what I was going to say. Crenshaw notes that wisdom was meant not to rock the boat. It was meant to preserve the status quo. And we all know, looking at our history, what the status quo has done in this country to undergird racism, systemic racism, sexism, and gender oppression. So the status quo needs to be rocked. It needs to be questioned. There's really very little room for that in wisdom literature except in the books of Job and Ecclesiastes. Now, I don't interpret Job as most of you do. Job did not repent of anything except trying to get God to see Job's point of view because he realized it was a futile effort. But he didn't repent of sin. He had no sin to repent of. But that's another class. And you can take Paul Cho's class on Job if you like. So what we get in the snippet that Jean read was a segment from Proverbs 1 through 9, which is probably a later addition to the book. And Proverbs are short, pithy sayings that sum up life according to the two ways. For example, Proverbs 11:8, the righteous are delivered from trouble and the wicked get into it instead. Easy peasy, right? Here's one way, here's another. Many proverbs were taken up with some tweaks in Benjamin Franklin's Poor Richard's Almanac and were passed down to you by your grandparents, like an apple a day keeps a doctor away, pride goes before a fall. There's one that you've probably heard. Check out Proverbs 16:18 for the provenance of that setting that Benjamin Franklin tweaked. So what we have here is a major wisdom theme, the theme of the two ways. There is the way of the righteous that leads to blessing and the way of the wicked that leads to punishment and death. Very clear paths. Psalm 1 lays out those paths in a proverb in verse 6. God knows the way of the righteous, that knowing is that special divine knowing, but the way of the wicked will perish. This two ways thinking runs throughout the Hebrew Bible. Sinai covenant is rooted in the two ways. Deuteronomy 30 urges the Israelites to choose between life and death by keeping or disobeying the commandments. The prophets preach that Israel went into its various exiles and experienced trauma because it violated covenant. Now, please don't think somehow Jesus in the New Testament made this thinking obsolete. Jesus surpassed that, overcame it. If you preach that and teach that, I will haunt you. And yes, God's grace can interrupt the two ways at any time, as texts in both parts of our canon make clear. But take a look at Galatians 6:7. God will not be mocked. You reap what you sow. Sounds like the two ways, doesn't it? James 3:13 through 18, which is steeped in wisdom thinking, contrasts earthly and heavenly wisdom in its consequences. Matthew 7:13 through 14 talks about the narrow gate that leads to life, and not everyone can enter through the narrow gate. And in the book of Revelation, only those washed by the blood of the Lamb can enter the heavenly Jerusalem. These texts are all steeped in two ways thinking. And what are heaven and hell but the final destinations of the two ways? Two ways thinking helps us make sense of the world and our place in it. For ancient Israel, wisdom was about survival. I'm very critical of wisdom, but I realize that it was birthed in the context of suffering. David Carr, in his book, Holy Resilience, argues that both parts of our Bible, both parts, were formed in the context of centuries of catastrophic suffering, unquote. He asserts that, quote, suffering and survival of it was written into the Bible, unquote. Carr calls the crucifixion of Jesus Christianity's founding trauma. So, where does woman wisdom come into this notion of the two ways in trauma? The oldest part of Proverbs, chapters 10 through 30, probably dates from the 10th or 9th century BCE, the time of King Solomon. It contains folk wisdom, much of it rooted in the daily life of the family and its survival. The final form of the book, with its frame comprised of two women, is, as I said, probably much later. And the two women appear in Proverbs 1 through 9. Woman wisdom and her superhero counterpart, the woman of worth, in Proverbs 31. And by the way, she exhausts me. She is an impossible standard for any of the women in this room. No. So that bookend of the two women probably came much later in the post-exilic period of return from Babylonian exile under the Persians in the 6th century BCE. Now, granted, there's all kinds of debate about the date. I'm not getting into that. This is kind of the consensus view. So this time of return was a time of disorientation and a search for Jewish identity. Ah, final essay. Those in my intro class, search for identity, Persian period. Make note of that. The final form of the Book of Proverbs asserts order in the midst of chaos for the Jews of the return. In Proverbs 1 through 9, two women personify the two ways: the strange woman, or woman folly, who is other, on the outside of what is socially accepted. We can call her the evil twin of woman wisdom. The strange woman combines all the negative roles of women and fears of men about women, particularly the sages, because they were a misogynistic bunch, believe me. While woman wisdom combines all the positive accepted roles of women in ancient Israel. Both women are male projections and stereotypes. Let's hear hiss and boo. Both women stand on busy street corners out in public, trying to lure impressionable young men to follow them to either ruin or successful living. Can you imagine these two on TikTok today? Seriously, I kept thinking about that last night. What kind of video would they post on TikTok? And who do you think would be the bigger influencer? I'm betting on woman folly myself. Yeah? Later, woman wisdom becomes identified with the Torah in Judaism. You can see that in the Wisdom of Sirach in the Apocrypha in chapter 24. And with the spirit of Sophia, the breath of the power of God in the Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 7. However, she was replaced, elbowed out, by early Christians who described Jesus using the language and imagery associated with woman wisdom. As in John 1, in the beginning was the Logos, the word. Chokmah, the feminine singular word for wisdom in Hebrew Bible, was replaced by the masculine singular Logos. See Sharon Ringey's book, Wisdom's Friends, for how this came about. It seems probable that woman folly and woman wisdom resonated with, or perhaps reflected, Ezra and Nehemiah in the 5th century BCE, who commanded that Jewish men returning from Babylonian exile divorce their foreign wives and disown the children from their marriages for the sake of the community's survival as Jews. Because if the Jewish man died, the land in his name, part of his covenant inheritance, would be given over to a child who is not fully Jewish, but the child of a foreign mother. There's that evil foreign woman again, standing in a long line of evil women like Potiphar's wife, Jezebel, and Solomon's foreign wives, who turned away his heart after other gods, according to 1 Kings 11, verse 4. That trope has been absolutely damaging to marginalized women everywhere, and particularly to women of color. Survival at the expense of inclusiveness, at the expense of questions about the status quo. I do not hold Ezra and Nehemiah up as leaders to be emulated. Stay tuned for my forthcoming book about knocking biblical characters off their pedestals in terms of who we turn to for leadership. It was, after all, the elites of Jerusalem who had been forcibly marched to Babylon, and the descendants of those elites who resumed their leadership after the return from exile. And yet, I realize that survival is tricky, as my granddaughter Eliza Rose would say. When she is confronted by something confusing or a little frustrating, her parents will say, "That's tricky." And she'll say, "Yeah, that's tricky." How does a group maintain its identity when its very existence is threatened? Okay, that's the theological component. What about the pedagogical element in woman wisdom? Now, I certainly do not want to claim that in my 37 years at Wesley, I have been like woman wisdom, dispensing instruction that she describes as truth, right, better than jewels. There is danger in that claim and a good bit of arrogance, and I would never claim that. My problem with woman wisdom as teacher is that she dispenses divine oughts, tells us what we should do. She certainly shows passion in doing so. Parker Palmer, former theologian at the Quaker Hill community of Pendle Hill, the Quaker community of Pendle Hill, puts it this way. Knowledge begins not in a neutrality, but in a place of passion within the human soul, unquote. This passion is, I think, the flip side, the human side of the passion with which God seeks us to know and to love us. From Genesis 3 on, throughout the whole Bible, God persistently asks, "Where are you?" It is this divine, passionate seeking to know us and not promise and fulfillment that unites the two parts of our Christian canon. Teachers cannot, like woman wisdom or the sages of ancient Israel, claim to have experience all summed up. They can observe till the cows come home and say, this is the way it usually works, but there will always be something that blows that up. Teachers cannot claim to have the last word, nor should they dictate one interpretation of a text, because our Bible is multifocal, multi-layered. This does not mean that anything goes. Some interpretations are just wishful or hateful thinking, and they need to be stopped. My challenge to woman wisdom is that the energy necessary for good teaching is not the energy of authority. Yeah, we have our PhDs, colleagues, yes. That is the authority that we must assume before we can walk in the classroom. But rather, the energy necessary for good teaching is the energy of vulnerability and openness. The energy that comes from listening to the Holy Spirit, to the text, to others who are reading the text. It's an energy birthed by the questions we put to the text in our ethical encounter with it. I realize, however, that my fellow teachers of color, for them, this kind of vulnerability is risky. And it takes more energy than I need to muster in a classroom to be that vulnerable. I'm not saying that energy and passion flow only in one direction, out of the teacher. That's arrogant too. Many times I have dreaded walking into the classroom. I'm sorry, students, but there are times when I really didn't want to see you, okay? And that is because my passion was gone. There was no energy, only to come away absolutely recharged and say, that was the best class ever. Why? Because my students were engaged with the text. They showed me something I hadn't seen before, and their energy flowed into me. It's a two-way street. So, to conclude, when I look back at my decades of teaching, I am drawn again to Rilke's fourth letter. The young man to whom he was writing asked Rilke if Rilke thought his poems were good. And Rilke himself was very young at the time, 27, and barely published. And Rilke's response is about the act of writing, but I think it describes the act of teaching as well. He writes, quote, "Go within, search for the cause, find the impetus that bids you write. Put it to this test. Does it stretch out its roots in the deepest place of your heart? Can you avow that you would die if you were forbidden to write? If you can confidently meet this serious question with a simple, I must, then build your life upon it. It has become your necessity." Unquote. Teaching has been my necessity all these years. I have built my life upon it. It has been my privilege as a teacher to help you to honor the questions. Please don't make me haunt you for ignoring them. Amen.
Invite you to stand back up as we respond in song to Lady Wisdom, Lady Folly, whoever you are, God sees you, God knows you, and we can praise God in that. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of the name El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Kalam Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Through your love and through the ram, you saved the son of Abraham. Through the power of your hand, you turned the sea into dry land. To the outcast on her knees, you were the God who truly sees. And by your might, you set your children free. Let's sing the chorus again. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Elyon Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of your name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Keram Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. One more. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elam Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of your name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Keram Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai.
Let us pray in the form as found in our worship guide. O God of compassion and empowerment, we pray, where there are ignorance and superstition, let there be enlightenment and knowledge. Where there are prejudice and hatred, let there be acceptance and love. Where there are fear and suspicion, let there be openness and trust. Where there are tyranny and oppression, let there be freedom and justice. Where there are disease and poverty, let there be health and enough for all. Where there are strife and war, let there be harmony and peace. Gracious God, we come before you with all the needs on our hearts, needs that we know, needs that we don't know. Among those that we lift up to you is a longtime member of the Wesley community, Mary Bates Washington and her husband Archie, for recovery and health. For recovery and health of all those individuals whom we already know and love. For the recovery and health of all those communities, those we know and love, and those we have yet to know and yet to love. Gather all our prayers in, God, all the words which have been said and heard and thought. Let you haunt us for the purpose of hallowing us. And let us pray not as compliant reciters using the passive voice. Let us pray in conversation with the needs of the world, using our bodies, using our thoughts, using our hearts. Let us look for your image in each one around. Let us serve that image, Lord, that each may see and learn your image in us, that your kingdom may come on earth as already it has in heaven. Amen.
Stand as you're able.
Friends, before Denise pronounces the benediction, you will have the final word, Denise. Would like to welcome all of you to a celebration over lunch on behalf of the President, David McAllister Wilson, the Dean's Office. Please come and enjoy lunch. There will be toasting and hopefully some roasting of Denise while we share laughter and really celebrate with her and celebrate the family as well. Please come and join us, Denise.
Receive this blessing and be grateful. Yevorkaka Adonai v'yishmereka. Ya'er Adonai panav eleka v'chuneka. Yisa Adonai panav eleka v'yasem lecha shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May Adonai deal kindly and graciously with you. May Adonai bestow favor upon you and grant us all peace. Amen.